Hey folks, welcome back to Math Teacher Lounge. I'm Dan Meyer.
And I'm Bethany Lockhart-Johnson.
Bethany, before we get started, I was thinking earlier about favorite Math Teacher Lounge moments from teaching. I was in a one department, no physical lounge, and one school had a physical lounge, and I was recalling back to like coffee runs. Is that a concept for you? Like you and your, you know, your best three teachers, your buddies, like going out, grabbing like orders from other teachers in the department, getting coffee, coming back, being the hero. Is that registered
being the
for
hero.
Anybody?
Yeah, I was actually part of this kind of cool coffee club that you had one day a week. So everyone had their same orders. None of this like go around, get orders. You had your order. I was, I think, a Tuesday. So every Tuesday it was my job to go get the coffee. But the other 4 days of the week, coffee just appeared. It was kind of magical.
That's efficient. That is a process right there. You folks had
Hello.
It dialed in. I love it.
Do you know how fast that bell rings? So today we are talking about hands down speak out, listening and talking across literacy and math K through five. And we have the authors here, Kassia Omohundro Wedekind and Christy Hermann Thompson. Before we begin, let's define what a hands down conversation is. A hands down conversation is just another way to structure discourse in your classroom. So in a typical classroom, you might see students raising their hand and waiting on a teacher to call on them before they share their ideas or engage in discussion. But in a hands-down conversation, it's students' ideas and voices that are taking the lead, and teachers are stepping back and focusing on listening and facilitating. Hello, welcome to the lounge.
Thank you, we're excited to be here. We're fans of season one, so we're ready to go.
I was a secondary teacher, and I still found so much to love about the book. I think facilitating conversations is just generally challenging, and perhaps even more so in math, where answers feel so tightly dialed in lots of ways. But I loved it. I would love for you to just explain to our audience, like, what is a hands-down conversation, and how does that contrast with like what might be standard practice for some people for some classes?
We just started using the term hands-down conversation because we wanted to differentiate the fact that there are different times to have different types of dialogue in the math classroom, in the literacy classroom. And we use this as one of our tools, right? It's not like that every day, all day long, we're very against hand raising and should never see that again. We find that having this as one of our tools will be where we make really clear to the students that this is a moment where we're turning it over to you to negotiate the space and make the decisions about when your voice comes in and who speaks next, you know, carry on kind of like that dinner table or that playground or, you know, whatever is your natural habitat for talk, and bringing that into the classroom and then hoping that it also someday transfers back out of the classroom back into the real world.
For the teachers who feel like that's terrifying to have students just start speaking and speaking without any sort of control or my little equity sticks, my little popsicle sticks or my popcorn or whatever other thing they're using, what would you say is the first step?
So I think like recognizing and naming that fear is part of it. And then saying to yourself, what's the worst that could happen here? You know, I think the worst that could happen is that nobody talks and it's totally silent. Or on the other hand, everybody talks at the same time. And both of those things will happen. And so what? It's going to be messy. And if you just acknowledge that it's going to look messy and that you know that that's part of growing, that every child as they learn and every adult is messy as they grow.
And we have to see what kinds of things will happen in a hands-down conversation. Like there's no prerequisite. You just start and then you see what happens. And those are the signs that tell you like what can help this community grow as talkers and listeners. If everyone's talking at the same time and they're kind of pushing each other over with their words by saying, I have something to add or something like that. That's a common thing that sometimes happens at the beginning. Then you know that the next step is to do some work about how to hold your thoughts back, how to wait for a space in the conversation to talk. And those are all things we need people to know out in the world.
So can you give an example of a micro lesson that, well, first, what do you define as a micro lesson? And then What's an example of one that maybe somebody who wants to dip their toe into the world of hands-down conversations that they could try?
The reason we call them micro lessons is because we wanted to differentiate from the term mini lesson, which is out there and tends to describe about 10 or 15 minutes that might take place at the beginning of a work period time. And this is much smaller than that. We usually follow a pretty predictable structure of naming, here's this thing that's so helpful when we're having conversations. And we love to especially be able to name something that a student has done. Kaylee did this yesterday and it really helped us. So what we might call that is, and then here's how Kaylee and other people might do that. They might do something like this and, you know, having a little anchor chart. So there's a visual reminder of that skill. So when we're having a conversation today, you could try. And that's basically a micro lesson just in a nutshell.
When I was doing these hands-down conversations and I had more space for myself to listen as a teacher, I'm like, well, look at those kids like slumped onto the ground, like pulling the carpet apart, but they're having like this amazing conversation. And so I learned that listening is a lot broader. So in this lesson that I'm thinking about, we just talk with kids about what are lots of different ways that listening can look like. Sometimes with younger kids, I'll take pictures of them listening in different ways and we'll notice things about them together. And then we invite them to talk with their Turning Talk partner about like, how do you like to be listened to? Or tell me about how you listen. And just kind of broaden that. And really, I like to think that like the micro lessons are for the kids, but also I'm saying those things to say them for myself. Like, remember, like you don't have to insist that kids are staring each other down in the eyes all the time. Like, it's okay when they're doing other things, there's other ways of listening. So I think I've learned as much from the micro lessons each time I do them as the kids that I'm trying to help grow as listeners and talkers as well.
You folks have a lot of really eloquent ideals you express around democratic classrooms and engagement, but you also have like just some very tangible, practical, even down to like how a teacher positions their body in space and the way they use their eyes to connect. I think it would be really helpful for teachers to hear that it's not just they're signing on to a manifesto of sorts, but there's like ways they can act their way into the beliefs that you both expressed here.
When I'm starting hands-down conversation work, if I put myself a little bit outside of the circle and look down and give myself a clipboard, it helps me bite my tongue and it helps me give better wait time and see what the kids are doing before I have that tendency to jump in and teach and do lots of teachery things.
Kassia and Christy, thank you so much for joining us. We are so excited to have this conversation and to share your work. This is exciting, and I feel like this conversation is just the beginning of a deeper dive into this book.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
We could not contain our conversation about Hands Down, Speak Out to just one interview. So we hope you'll head on over to our Facebook group, Math Teacher Lounge, to find out how you can join us in a book study over the next few months, culminating in a webinar with the authors in January. We'll see you there. Thanks so much for tuning in. You can find Math Teacher Lounge on Twitter at MTL Show, or you can also find us on Facebook in our group Math Teacher Lounge, where we have more conversations just like this, including excerpts from other interviews, more talk with Kassia and Christy, as well as more information about upcoming projects. Thanks so much for joining us.